Chapter 12. A diegesis spoken by Julia Felix. I shall always remember that first time I saw my cousin Nikos. He had come back from the east and now was regaling my grandfather with talk of those fabled cities and monuments in Egypt and Syria. I did not understand until later the exact nature of the relationship between those two men, one young, one old. I only knew them as my grandfather and my cousin. Later, my mother and her sisters explained it to me. Uncle, Nikos said, and I must tell you, he always called my grandfather uncle. Uncle, you should see the temple the Jews built in their city on the hill, miles above the Dead Salt Sea. Sounds more like a mythological wonder than any work of architecture, my son. The grandfather always called him son, even though he was not physically any relationship at all, except ex-slave and former master. Yes, so you see how much easier they should call each other uncle and son. I never met Nicodemus' father, although I knew his mother and was present at their reunion that day Nikos came to see us. His mother was very quiet, only cried a little and smiled a lot and held his hand. Until 10 years ago, she had thought he was either dead or lost at sea. But then word had come. He was alive, studying in Alexandria. Now he had come back. More, he was an imperial servant. Lida knew my grandfather wanted to talk and listen, so she simply sat beside her son and enjoyed the miracle of his return. I was only 12, remember, so I sat a few feet away with my mother and aunts, but we saw everything and heard almost all the words they spoke. This was all done in the open, for all of us, and so my grandfather would have said, it was a family matter. Later, I learned he was concerned Nikos would not be allowed to stay with us for very long, and sure enough, as I mentioned the other night, soldiers came to escort him away. Still, we had a few hours and ate a light lunch together. Let's see, there were about 15 or 20 of us that day of family, not counting the servants, of course. It was beautiful. One of those days. There are many here, depending on your time of year and what hour it was. It was one of those shining warm days. Not too hot, not yet. And we crowded out into the street to bid Nikos farewell as he rode off with the two soldiers in their twin chariots. A few weeks later, we heard the strange news. Our divine emperor was building a bridge of boats across a piece of the bay from Puteoli to Bai. Then we received the command to join the celebration as he marched across the floating road over the water. They tell me it was about 5 miles long. Late at night, after we finally got back home. Mama explained to me in secret whispers that no one could hear. And she made me promise never to speak of this secret fear that Nicodemus had told her, that Caligula was afraid of the sea and of the sea god Neptune, or Poseidon, as the Greeks call him, and that because of his fear, he was making war against the very waters of the deep. "He must be mad, Mama," I whispered. "Did he take poison or drink too much wine?" "Hush, child, now. Just you rest now. And remember, things are not always what they seem." "Yes, Mama. Thank you for taking me with you to the parade. It was a little frightening, but I felt safe there because of Nicodemus, even if we didn't get to see him." "Yes, dear, but he knew we were there and that we were helping him just by being there." It's true we did not see my cousin, but I had seen the emperor ride by on his famous horse with two of his favorites following in a shining golden chariot drawn by a pair of beautiful milk-white horses. We all cheered and cried out, "Mars! Jupiter, Minerva," that, I am happy to say, was the only time I ever saw the emperor, that emperor, in person. He smiled at us, and he looked away. As for his war with Neptune, come to find out, this wasn't the only time, for it seems a year later, the divine emperor Caligula ordered hundreds of legionary soldiers to gather seashells on the beaches of the northern sea instead of crossing over to invade Britain. Then he declared victory over the god of the ocean sea and returned to Italy. "Well, now we have a good one, a strong one, and a wise one he is," they say. "But his brother is questionable. We shall see." One never knows what changes may come tomorrow, as the saying goes, except that almost every tomorrow will be the same as yesterday and today, as our old friend Nico says. Yes. Poor man, he really is getting older. Thank the gods, or the God, as some people say. Well, just thank heaven for the good fortune that now he will still be living with his daughter and with her new husband, Nikos' old friend, Timaeus. Two birds, proverb. Yet we still have the problem of Domitianus wanting her. I know that little detail may prove troublesome. I hope I can get Lydia ready for the big game hunt, if he decides to chase her. If. Who am I kidding? There is no if. I already know he wants her. The only other possible explanation is each of my three friends in Rome is lying to me about him. That I do not believe. Well, then, at least she will be married soon. That step is important. But no, I will leave that other step to Providence. Yes. That is in this first draft, which is now so far about 100 pages. That is chapter 12. I've only written 11 before this.